Good evening, everyone. Baruch Hashem, this upcoming parasha on Shabbat, parashat Korach, is a parasha that is a lot to learn from. We're going to speak about some ideas from the parasha that relates to our life. Bezrat Hashem. You know, last week, if you remember, we spoke here on last Monday, we spoke about hidden agendas. Thank you. Thank you, Tzadik. Hidden agendas. What's hidden agendas? It's not what you say, it's why you said it. 90% of the things in our life, that's the right description. It's not what you say, it's why you are saying what you're saying. 99% of the people in the world are not clever enough to detect between the lines what the person really is saying. They're paying attention literally to what comes out of his mouth. But that's a very big mistake. The sharper your brain gets, the faster you get what's hidden behind what he said. And based on that, you react. For instance, if you're a judge, a lawyer, a marriage counselor, you're going to need that skill. Speaker, rabbi, you're going to need that skill to read between the lines what people really mean to say. That's a huge advantage in life, huge. You don't understand, it changed your entire way, the way you conduct business, the way you raise your children, the way you behave in your relationships. It's totally different, mamash, totally different. Since most people cannot see deep inside and read in between the lines, they actually react based on the wrong information. Yes, they heard what they heard and they answer what they answer, but they really didn't get the point. Add on top of it that besides the hidden agendas and what people really meant to say when they say something is also the body language. That's another school for life, the body language. Body language is very, very important. Much more important than the mouth language, what comes out of your mouth. You can give me an hour speech, convince in any possible way, and few of the movements of your body already describe a whole opposite scenario. Totally opposite. If people don't know body language, it's another problem because they don't have that advantage. Last week, we spoke about the spies that came and described what they saw. Like they say in Israel, they played Rosh Katan. In Israel, there are two expressions, Rosh Gadol and Rosh Katan. It's a slang. Rosh Gadol means big head. Rosh Katan means small head. Small head means play dumb. You know the people that play dumb? They're not really dumb. They just play dumb. Someone hint to them about a problem. They don't have the head. They don't want to help now. So they pretend they don't understand. Or if someone give them an assignment, they got the whole picture. But they play dumb. Oh, I thought you only want this and that. You didn't tell me this, but it was obvious. But that's called play dumb, Rosh Katan. Rosh Gadol is the exact opposite. You have a secretary, you tell her, I want this and this and that, if you can, to finish by today. By the end of the day, she finished three times more. She finished here, she finished there, she cleaned. Why? She is not only reacting to what she must do. She want to do much more. You understand? As I gave you an example from Dr. Cohen, the dentist here in Union Turnpike, when the guy from the yeshiva come that, you know, is taking care of them for free for years, he doesn't just do it because that's what the guy needs. He needs feeling right now and he has pain. Let me do the feeling and send him home. No. While he's there, he makes an x-ray and check if there's other cavities and maybe there's root canal and maybe this and maybe that, maybe he needs cleaning. Even though there are customers that are paying, they are waiting, he rather takes care of the Talmid Yeshiva for free because he understands it's a trillion times more important than to take care of a customer. He understands that, he's smart. Because he looks at the entire picture for long run, not for an immediate profit of $200-$300. It may look, but right now, may lose a customer. You know, if there's so many people waiting, what's going to happen in the end? Maybe one of them will get up and leave, and he just lost $200 to his pocket today, while he was taking care of a Bachur Yeshiva who paid him nothing. That's a foolish thinking. That's ignorance. That's someone who thinks like this, he doesn't know the principle of Judaism, doesn't understand the Torah, or if he does understand, then he's an infidel, worse, kufir. It's heresy to think that what's written in the Gemara, it's not always, or it's incorrect, or it's not relevant, or that's an exaggeration, that's kfira. Kfira, it's heresy. You're not a believer. It's a matter of believing. I'll give you an example. Something that happened a few hours ago. There is a guy, a very young, very nice guy from Englewood, New Jersey. Israeli guy. He works in, handyman, whatever, he gives services. Religious guy. He went on a trip. Okay, went on a trip. He came back. Before he went on a trip, he told me, I would like to donate 200 of your books to give it to people that you feel that they need it and they won't buy it. Meaning, start give, like you give out CDs for free, USBs, give this also. I said, very good. We have the special, everyone who buys more than 100 books get 50% off, you know that deal, okay. He said, I don't have time now to see you to give you the check, but when I come back from my trip, I'll give you the check. No problem, I say. I'm going to start giving them out. While he was away, I gave 50 of them from the 200. Today called me up. I'm back. When do you want to meet tomorrow? Where we going to be? Where I'm going to be? Okay, we'll try to meet tomorrow. Then he can give me the balance, meaning the money. He asked me, how many of them you gave? I told him, 50. In 2 weeks, I gave 50 of them. I said, okay, very good. What should we do with the 150? We're trying to think what to do with them. Who should we give them to them? I said to him, don't worry. Leave it to Hashem. Hashem knows who needs it. It's going to come. We'll see who needs it. Who cannot afford, whatever. I hung up the phone with him. 2 minutes exactly after. 2 minutes. I can show you the times. You can see when I hung up with him and when the email came in. 2 minutes. Not three. 2 minutes. 2 minutes after we finished the conversation, I got an email. Someone who is active in Kiruv, in Florida, discovered my book. And this is the email. Rabbi, I have a great idea. I go to jails to visit Jewish prisoners that are in horrible condition there, mentally, physically, whatever. I try to bring their spirit up and to make them religious. I think it would be a great idea to give, I have a list of 150 Jewish prisoners. 150, not 149, not 151. 150 Jewish prisoners that can very much use the knowledge of your book to become Baalei Tshuva. But I don't have the budget to buy the books. 2 minutes later, that's when you know that God loves you. You don't need more than that. He loves what you do, that's it. So he does the job for you. Melechet tzadikim na'aset bidei acherim, as Chazal say. He loves this guy, this Israeli guy, from his heart. Give the books to strangers. Why? Let's save a few more Jews on the way. You understand? That's That's impressive. So, but going back to what I started, behind every sentence there is a hidden agenda. Of course, not always, most of the time. I give you an example. You know how they say in America there's always a but? You are this and you are that and da 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 da, but the entire list of compliments was only for one reason, not because he really wants to compliment you or he likes you or appreciate you. It was only to get to the criticism. That's what the Torah say to do. If you want to rebuke a person, you want to be mochiach. Ochiach tochiach et amitecha velo tisa alav chet. Ochiach tochiach et amitecha. Meaning, you have to rebuke your brothers. You have to rebuke your brothers. Otherwise, you'll be responsible for the crimes you commit. Because you could have stopped it. By not rebuking another Jew that he can save his life, by not giving him a book, by not giving him few CDs or USB, by not doing everything you can to get him to become religious, you break a rule of the Torah. Besides, you should rebuke your brother. This is one obligation that you violate. There is another violation that you create now. What is it? Which sin you pass now? You violate. Who knows? I give you a hint. If you walk in the street and there's a lake next to you under the bridge and a Jew is drowning, help, scream to you, help, help. And you look at him and you continue to walk and he drowned and died. What sin you just made? What's the name of that? Huh? One, ve'avta le'reacha kamocha. But, ve'avta le'reacha kamocha, not always, because there's no obligation to love every Jew, like some rabbis say. It's incorrect. It's not true. You read in Rabbeinu Yonah, you read in Orchot Tzadikim, the most two important Sifrei Musar in history, repeated many, many times, also Chafetz Chaim, that the obligation to love every Jew is only Re'acha LaMitzvot, someone that loves Hashem and listens to Him, not someone who rebel against Him. Those are the people you have no obligation to love them whatsoever. Still have an obligation to try to save them, because it gives a peace of mind and happiness to Hashem when His children are returning back to Him. But, there is no such thing that you should love everyone. No. Only those who follow the path of Hashem, there's obligation to love them. Amitcha l'mitzvot. I asked once my cousin, he's a very big Talmid Chacham, huge, one of the biggest in the world. I told him, based on this, then every Jew must stand on Shabbat on a road, in every road, instead of going to shul, instead of going to learn Torah, instead of eating chulent, every Jew has to stand on a road and scream, Shabbat, Shabbat, in Israel, when they see all the other Jews are driving. How they let them drive? It's not possible. So he told me, no, there's no such an obligation. The obligation is Re'acha LaMitzvot, not someone is an apikores, he decided to rebel against Hashem. Someone is a clown, let's. He makes fun. You speak to him about religion, he makes fun. You have no obligation to rebuke him anymore. He brought it on himself, Chazal say. It's written in Orchot Tzadikim. Someone who does not accept criticism and he does not want anyone to rebuke him, when he will pay for his sins, he can only blame himself. Why? Because why nobody wanted to tell you the truth? Because you're an angry lion. You don't accept the truth. You're full of ego. You're full of arrogance. You don't want to hear the truth. You don't want to change. Nobody wants to waste a minute on you. Same thing with the doctor. Doctor has two patients. One, nice, gentleman, appreciate. When you give him an advice, he runs and do it. Tell him, stop eating this, doing that. Get this medicine. Get these vitamins. You see right away, he calls you. I did it. Should I do this? He cares. So the doctor automatically cares about him. But if you see an arrogant criminal, full of ego that looks at you, you know, like he's on the top of them of the mountain and you all the way in the bottom. And whatever you tell him anyway, he looks at you like you have no idea what you're talking about. You have no incentive to have such a thing. He can die as far as he's concerned. That's his problem, not mine. I tell him what to do. You want to do it, do it. You don't want to do it, I can care less. Which patients the doctor really care about? The ones who care about themselves. The ones who behave. Not the one who gives them the dirty attitude. Just like in every other store. You go in a store. Some customers, the people in a bigger store, they like to see them walking in the morning. And some customers, it's their nightmare. They don't want to look at them. I remember when I came to America, it was 1989, I worked in a bagel store in Great Neck, Middle Neck Road. The store, the bagel store used to open at 6 a.m. There used to be a Jew comes with a Rolls Royce every morning, 10 to 6. I don't know, I guess his schedule was that he has to pass by there 10 to 6. 10 to 6, he used to come, the windows are all full of steam from the baking of the bagels. You cannot really see. But already after a while, I already knew it's him. Who's going to knock on the door at 10 to 6? You know, I was a man probably 60 years old. You can see right away, he's a very rich person. And later I found out he's some kind of a judge in a court, but he used to come, knock on the door. I'm curious, why someone knock on the door? I open the door, yes, can I help you? Listen, I mean, I know you're opening in 10 minutes, but can you do me a favor? What? Can you cut for me some lox? He used to buy a dozen bagels and lox. But they have to cut it with a knife, you know. Yeah, I try to be nice. Okay, fine, even the store is not open. I didn't know who he is. Every morning he used to come, I used to cut lox for him, give me $20 tip. 1990 it was. It's like $40 today. I used to make the whole day $70, working like a slave. Every morning Hashem sent me that Jew, I opened it 10 minutes before. Now imagine if the first time I was nasty. What do you mean, man? I'm going to open the store for you? Who do you think you are? Wait with your Rolls Royce another 10 minutes. Most people, that's what they would do. How much money you would lose? Do the math. Doing nothing. What do I care if I cut it at 10 to 6 or 6 or 1? This is what life is all about. The Gemara say, what you give, that's what you get. You're nice, people are nice back to you. You're nasty, nobody can stand you. And the Holocaust in Kristallnacht, they burned close to 1,300 synagogues in Europe. Rabbi Yosef Ben Porat is a brilliant genius in everything that relates to the Holocaust. A very, very smart person with lots of knowledge. He knows, from what I've seen, almost every detail you can imagine. All the books, you many years learn, speak about it, write books about it. I heard in one of his speeches that he said that all the 1,300 synagogues that were burned were all Reform. I don't know his source, but I'm telling you what I heard from him. That all the synagogues that got burned in that night were all Reform synagogues, which are actually, according to the Torah, worse than a church. Church is a place of idol worshiping. When you go into a Christian church, it's a sin to step inside. Not only for Jews, also for Gentiles. If a Gentile walk into a church, If a Gentile walk into a church, it's a sin just to step inside. It's a place of idol worshiping. Same thing Jew, needless to say. Because Gentiles also not allowed to be idol worshippers. If you walk into a mosque, it's not a sin. Because a mosque, it's not a place of idol worshiping. They don't worship a son of God or a partner to God or anything like that. They worship the one God, the God of the Torah. They just claim that they have a prophet named Muhammad, which we know he was not a prophet. He didn't even know how to read and write. Not to talk about prophecy, okay? But, okay, they have false beliefs. But as far as worshiping the same God, they worship the same God. But when you go to the church, they worship two gods. The God of the Torah and JC, that they made him into a god. That's an idol worshiping. It's a very serious sin. So if you're an electrician, you walk into a church to change a light bulb, it's already a sin. Even if they pay you for that, cannot even step inside. So that's already an idol worshiping. Just there, just to walk inside. So Reform synagogue is much worse than a church. Why? Because in a church, there is one main sin against God. What is it? Idol worshiping. One sin. All Christians commit one sin in Christianity. By inventing Christianity, they made one major sin, which is Avodah Zarah. That's it. It's not murder. It's not Gilui Arayot. It's none of the rest of the sin. One. One of the seven laws the Gentiles have to keep, they break. Which is, by the way, death penalty even for Gentiles. Not only for Jews. Idol worshiping. So they break one rule. When you go into a Reform synagogue, every second over there, it's breaking every rule of the Torah. They modify the whole Torah. They break Shabbat. They break Yom Kippur. They break the holidays. They marry men with men. They marry women with women. They marry people with animals. They marry Jews to non-Jews. They commit almost every possible crime against God. So which place is worse? Which place is worse? You have two murderers. One murder, one person per week. And one murder, 100 people per week. Which murderer is more dangerous? Obviously. Same thing over here. One place, declare a war against God in one subject. The other place, declare a war against God in every possible subject. Not only that. In the church, they can eat whatever they want. Goyim don't have to eat kosher food. There's a lot of things they're allowed to do. The Jews are not allowed to do. When you are obligated to do and you're not doing, it's a crime. If you're not obligated, it's not a crime. So in the night of the Kristallnacht, in Europe, there was one store that sells chocolate and sugar and tea, you know, candies. You know, the whole street is full of those streets. Maybe it was in Belgium, maybe in Germany. So after they burned all the synagogues and they burned a lot of the stores as well, where the Jews had mezuzot, they burned it. One Jewish righteous man and his son decided the next morning to go and see what's left from their business. When they arrived to the street, they walked and they saw all the streets are burned, everything. All the stores are burned completely. Everything. Now one store survived. When they came to the middle of the block, that's where the store supposed to be, they could not believe it. The store was standing over there, nothing was burned, completely standing. With all the merchandise inside, nobody touched their stores. All the other stores around, the whole area, everything is burned. There's only one store that was not burned. Which one? This store. They're shocked. How can it be? What's going on here? I mean, it's too much of a miracle. They open up the store, they check. Wow. Right away, the son said to his father, Dad, now we can make a lot of money. Let's triple the prices. We don't have competition anymore. The father said to him, shame on you. People lost everything they had. And now that's what you want to do to them? To triple the prices on them? To make money on the blood of other miserable people who lost everything they have? You don't change a penny on the prices. 11 a.m. after they opened, 2 hours later, a Jeep showed up with a Nazi soldier, officer, came out of the Jeep. He walks inside with his uniforms and hat. Hello? Yes, hi. The father thought, probably with us, who knows what they're going to do to us now. He said to him, you're probably wondering why nobody touched your store last night. And the Jew say, yes, I'm very surprised. He said, I want you to know that as soon as they started to say on the news that there are riots and people going all over and burning Jewish property, first thing came to my mind is you. And I ran quickly and stood by your door all night with my gun, and everyone who came to burn your store, I told him, this store, you, no one is allowed to touch. All night I was standing watching your store until everyone left here. He took out his hat. You remember me? You're recognizing me? You look familiar. A few years ago, I used to work for a candy company, chocolate, sugar. I used to be a delivery man. I used to bring to you boxes of food and candies. From all the Jews around this area, the only person that was nice to me always asked me how I feel, if I want to drink, if I want to eat, and came out with his son to help me with the boxes, were you and your son. No one else looked at me here. I was very happy to see those stores getting burned. But my heart did not let me allow them to burn your stores. So I came to watch your store all night. This story teaches so much about life. What you give, that's what you get. With Hashem, it's the same thing. Noach matza chen b'enei Hashem. Noach found favor in the eyes of Hashem. That's why Hashem loves him. That's why he thinks he's a tzaddik. No one else in the time of Noach found any favors in the eyes of Hashem. That's why he couldn't stand anyone. None of the wicked people that live in the time of Noach, Hashem liked. That's why he wiped them all out. And that's what he's going to do to the world very soon. Every minute you hear about a new gay parade, here and here and here, every block, every town, everywhere. I pass by Manhattan now, every other store have their flags now. Now it's in style. Like they want to brag, we're supporting you. The people that rebel against Hashem, we are with you. They're all going to get what they deserve. Just need to be patient. It happened once, it happened again in history, it will happen again. History, it's not 1, 2, 3. Every 5 minutes Hashem responds. No. Sometimes if you check the Tanakh, Hashem waited 500 years before he gave people what they deserve. 500 years. Give you one example. Cain and Abel lived 5,779 years ago. Almost 6,000 years ago. 5,800 years ago, approximately. When Cain actually finished to pay for his crime, for murdering Abel, some of the payments he got in his lifetime, that he was pushed away and isolated on a ban. But the main punishment was 2,400 years later, when his soul was reincarnated in another body, when he came back as Jethro. Jethro is Cain. And Moshe is Hevel. Jethro murdered Moshe in previous life when they used to be Cain and Hevel. Now he gave him Zipporah, his daughter, as a gift to make it up to him because he killed him because of a girl. That Hevel had two twins, twin girls, and Cain had only one. And remember, nobody knew about brother, sister, relationship, forbidden relationship. None of that existed. We were like animals in the nature. So because he was jealous, he murdered him. Then 2,400 years later, he had to come and give him a gift. What is it? A girl. I killed you for a girl, I'm giving you a girl. Who? My daughter Zipporah, which was a very righteous woman. And not only that, a part of the soul of Cain came in the body of the Egyptian that Moshe killed. The Egyptian was beating up the Jew. Moshe said in the name of Hashem, and the Egyptian died right away. And this Egyptian was Cain. So now Hevel killed Cain, measure for measure, but this time legally. Cain killed Hevel as a murder, illegal. Hevel killed Cain, legal, measure for measure. You kill, you get killed. You make an abortion, in your next life you will be a baby that will cut to pieces. What you did to the baby when you were pregnant as a woman, You're going to come back in another body, and that's what they're going to do to you. Where it's written? In Pirkei Avot. Hillel, the president of the Sanhedrin. One of the biggest chachamim in history. Hillel HaZaken, Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel. He saw a skeleton floating on a lake. And he said, someone murdered you. And that someone will be murdered. And you were murdered because you did murder. You murdered, you got murdered. And the one that murdered you will also get murdered. Measure for measure. Still 100, someone will steal from you. And someone will steal from him. You lost, you make someone lose, someone will make you lose. You ruin the life of someone. You call the yeshiva to tell them, I don't want my son to be in the same class with this kid. If you don't throw that kid, I'm going to speak to the parents not to send their kids to your yeshiva. You put pressure on them. You bully. You blackmail the principals. They're afraid to lose 10 children from the class because otherwise they're going to have to close the class. So you murder that kid because you're a selfish murderer. And someone will murder your son eventually, or you. If it's not in this life, it will happen in the next life. That explains why so many people suffer and you don't find what's their sin. They're not such monsters. Why they get such suffering? If you see the amount of suffering I hear every day, you cannot believe it. You cannot believe that some people have so many problems that I don't know how they're surviving. It's mamash hard to survive like this. All kinds of problems, sicknesses and rash and surgeries and this and that and no place to live. Wow. You cannot believe when Hashem is angry at someone, he is angry. And that someone is a real miserable person. So what do you see? You see that in the end it's all midah keneged midah. What you get, that's what you did to others. What you cook, that's what you're going to eat. You cannot run away from it. That's why I always been screaming for over 20 years already. Be clever, be wise. Don't make crimes and then cry and suffer to erase them. Be clever, don't make sins. Educate yourself to live according to the rules. It's very painful, even in life. Every camera here is, I don't know, $50 ticket. You drive in Ocean Parkway, you know, they have like 10 cameras over there. If you drive 1 mile in Ocean Parkway, instead of 30 miles, you drive 50, which is very easy to drive 50 in such a wide street, you're going to get 10 tickets, $500 in 1 mile. You're lucky there's no points because it's cameras. Just to give you one example, Ocean Parkway, from the prospect to the belt, 10 cameras. Each one of them will take a picture of you and they'll send you 10 tickets. In one street. Why? You got to pay for the consequences of your actions. Nothing you can do. That's the story of life. So let's go back to what I started. So it's not what people say. It's why they are saying it. Why they are saying it. Many times people say things and they mean something different. I'll give you an example. One person came to Rav Shach, Zatzal. Rav Shach was Rosh Yeshivat Ponovich. He was the head of the entire religious world. Sfaradim, Ashkenazim, everyone. Rav Shach was a serious leader. Rav Shach, many people came to cry to him about their problems. His door was open. He had a shamash, Sfaradi guy, his name Rav Schaik. Talmid Chacham, also rabbi. He's the shamash of Rav Shach. Rav Shach lived to 107 years old. Lived long life. He survived the Holocaust. He ran away days before they closed the gate of the port in his place. If you remember the story that his Rosh Yeshiva suggested that he should marry an orphan girl. And he said to him, where are we going to live? I don't know, I'm a Bachur Yeshiva, where should I live? And Rav Isser Zalman Meltzer, his Rosh Yeshiva, told him, you live in my living room. Imagine you learn in Yeshiva. Try to imagine if something like this is possible in today's generation. You learn in Yeshiva and you're very poor. The bar mitzvah of Rav Shach was that his mother sent him a pair of tefillin. That's it. It was not even l'chaim.
By Rav Chaim Kanievsky, there was at least l'chaim and few crackers. His father, the stipler, took cognac, poured it for the people. Rav Chaim Kanievsky put filin. They say mazal tov, they drank l'chaim, ate some crackers. The bar mitzvah was finished in 10 minutes. Not like today, $1 million bar mitzvah. For kids that will not keep one mitzvah. And they still call it bar mitzvah. It's the biggest scam in the history, bar mitzvah. There's few scams in the history. One, colleges. Biggest scam in the world. Scamming people, making 80% of the people in this country miserable. They have trillions of dollars of student loans. That this lunatic, Bernie Sanders, he wants to waive them all. After 100 years of scamming the people, and there are trillions of dollars in student loan with 6% interest, came this liberal lunatic suggesting that the government will wipe out trillions of dollars when the government owe $20 trillion to China. So Bernie suggests that maybe they'll add another $3 trillion to the debt with interest that they pay to China, that, you know, a lot of these students who are doing nothing in their life, because college never helped them, so at least they don't have to pay the scam of the government and the college. If you remember, I told you that Harvard University is richer than countries. Hundreds of countries in the world have less money in their saving account than Harvard University, who has hundreds of billions of dollars profit in the last 500 years. And not only that, a lot of liberal idiots leave everything they have to them when they die. Many of them are Jews. 100 million, 200 million, 300 million. Inheritance. To who? To one of the richest institutions in the world. And hard to believe what's going on here. But when you don't have Torah, what do you expect? You know, in Tenafly, I once spoke over there. There was one Reform Jew, not Reform, secular. He had few hours to live, few hours to live. And what happened? He asked the doctors if he can find him a rabbi to come be with him when he died. Before people die, they become religious. You know, at least 3 hours before, they remember that maybe you should call a rabbi. Tov, family that spoke against the Torah 80 years and make fun of the rabbis, 5 hours before their father died, they remember that rabbi can help with something maybe. So they call, they look for a rabbi. But which rabbi they're going to find in a newspaper? Reform. So they called some Reform rabbi in New Jersey. Rabbi, can you come and be with someone that is dying here? Hey, I'm sorry, I'm in a business meeting, I'm far, I'm not in the area. You know, excuses. Then they didn't know what to do. So they looked for Chabad. The goyim, the doctors, what Jewish institution they know? They don't know any besides Chabad. Chabad, everywhere they go, they see Chabad. They looked for Chabad in a newspaper, the phone book, and they called the rabbi of Tenafly to come to be with him in the last hour of his death. And he gave him a check. Some say $400 million, some say $150 million. The amount is tremendous. And with that check, he built a fancy Bet Chabad in Tenafly. I spoke there once. You have to see what a fancy place. I'm thinking about that Reform gay rabbi that probably until today sits and cries that he did not go. You know, he wouldn't know what to do anyway. If the Reform rabbi would come and sit with this Reform Jew before he died, would he know to say Shema Yisrael, Tziduk Adin? Would he know what to do? He doesn't know anything from his life. What does he know? He doesn't know. Maybe that's why he didn't want to go, because he didn't know what to do. Okay, this Chabadnik was a young rabbi. He went there. I forgot right now his name.
He went there, Rabbi Shane, I think, so whatever, something like this. The story is famous, everyone knows it in the area over there. He gave him a very nice check, and he built that place with that check. The good thing is that that Reformed Jew had some kind of a merit that he gave all his money to at least an Orthodox institution. Imagine if the other reform would come and take it from him, what exactly he would do with that? Make a gay club? What would he do with that? You know? So, going back to Rav Shach, so his Rosh Yeshiva told him, marry this orphan girl. He said, where would I live? Live in my living room. So he said to him, how can I live in your living room? There's already a couple living there. And it's small living room. It's not Fresh Meadow or Great Neck. You know the living room of Europe. It's all like a box, shoe box. There's already a couple living there. So where else another couple can live? So he told them, we'll take a blanket from the ceiling, stick it to the ceiling, and we'll divide the room to two halves. They would live in one half, and you will live in the other half. Meaning, if you want to stretch in the morning, you punch your friend's wife. Because her head is right here. You have to be intimate with your wife. Someone is right here. You can't even move. Imagine the life. But Rav Shach had emunat chachamim. If the rabbi said to live in his living room, I don't ask questions. I trust Hashem. Hashem sees everything. Hashem saw what I'm sacrificing here. Everyone told him, you crazy? You're the greatest guy in yeshiva. Each one of us got an apartment. You are the first one who should get the greatest apartment. Why would you settle to live in someone's living room with an orphan poor girl? Rav Shach told him, I don't know. The Rosh Yeshiva told me, marry this girl. She's a great girl. I like her. Why shouldn't I marry her? I don't have money. Money, Hashem has all the money in the world. It's no problem. I live in a living room for now. Let's see what's going to be. Weeks after, the Nazis arrived to town. Rav Shach said to his wife, what do we have to do here? We don't have anything. Let's get our two suitcases, get on a boat, and go to Israel. They went to Israel. A week after, Hitler, Yimach Shimo, closed all the borders. All his friends from yeshiva were all murdered. He's the only one that survived. Why? Because they had to wait to sell their apartments. They didn't want to leave the apartment and run. So until they sold the apartment, it was too late to leave. And what happened? They all died. He came to Israel, became Rosh Yeshiva, one of the most important yeshivas in the world. For the decades, he was a Rosh Yeshiva. One person walked into his house, in his office. He said to him, Rabbi, I need your help. What? One Rebbe that was teaching in my yeshiva decided to leave. And is opening another yeshiva nearby, in the same town. Lots of the kids would leave, they're going to go there, he's going to take kids with him, he's breaking my yeshiva to two. Please speak to him not to do it. After all what I suffered to open this place, Rav Shach opened his cabinet over there, the wall unit. It took a staff of $10,000. $10,000 in cash. He said to him, here, this is a donation to your yeshiva. The guy, his eyes opened up. Thank you, Rabbi. Mwah, mwah, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Shkoyach, shkoyach. He took it and ran away. His assistant, Rav Shaik, he said to him, Rabbi, what did he come to cry about? What did you answer him? Well, I don't get it. He said to him, I don't listen to what people tell me. I listen to what the real agenda is. What's in between the lines what really bothered them. They don't tell you up front what's the problem, the real problem. Why do you think he came to cry to me? That the other rabbi left? Nah, you have plenty of other rabbis. You can find someone else just as good. What was he worried about? That the people that sponsor his yeshiva now will give half to the other guy. He's worried about the money. So I gave him $10,000 in his time. It was like $50,000 today. I gave him, from all the donations that people gave, I gave him a nice amount to keep him for at least a year secure. The problem is over. It was not about the opening. This is in between the lines. One person came to Rav Yoel Misatmer. Rav Yoel Misatmer was a very zealous rabbi that was stuck to HaKadosh Baruch Hu in very high level. Very high level. And one person came to him and said, I have to marry my daughter, I don't have a penny, I don't know what to do, I'm depressed, I'm broken. So he said to him, how much you need? He said, $10,000 to make a wedding. Today it's $200,000. Back then it was $10,000. He went to his safe and he got him $9,950. $50 short. He said to him, I'm so sorry. I almost had what you needed. Almost the whole amount. I'm a little bit short. You short $50. Bezrat Hashem, Hashem will help you to collect the other $50. Thank you, Rabbi. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. A million times kissing, crying. Took the envelope and left. Yishamash told him, what's the story, Rabbi? There's a lot more money over there in the safe. Why you gave him $9,950? He said, I wanted him to appreciate the money. If I would give him the whole 10, he will not enjoy it at all. Because there's one thing would be in his mind, what a fool, why did I ask only for 10? Should have asked for 30. That greed will not leave him alone. So like this, he knows he squeezed me to the max. Because he thinks that's all I had. He cleaned me out. He feels so great. He aimed for 10 and he almost got the whole 10. If he would know I have another $100,000 in a safe, what do you think would be? What a stupid guy I am. I had the opportunity of my life. The rabbi is so generous. Gave me right away like this 10,000. Why didn't I ask for 30? Why didn't I ask for 50? That's it. That's the greed of people. Rabotai, this is a big advantage. This is how Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul was. See a person, rentgen, you know, read him right away. My cousin was his student for 12 years. From morning to night he learned with him. He got his skills. How many people like this you have in the world? I saw in my eyes, in my own eyes, I'm a witness, not stories. Me and my friend Shimon Navarro, another tzaddik that used to live here, and now he lives in Yerushalayim. We went to him when he used to teach by Orach Chaim Yeshiva, by Rav Reuven Elbaz. Rav Elbaz is the pioneer of the tshuva movement in the world. Remember, somebody asks you, who's the first rabbi in the last 100 years that invented the idea of going to secular people and starting to speak to them to make them Baalei Tshuva and bring them into Yeshiva for Shabbat and get the idea of talking to them and going to some bases and speak to the pilots and invites them to come to learn Gemara? This is Rav Reuven Elbaz. Remember this. He was the first one. When? More than 50 years ago. Before all these organizations, before you had organizations in America, before you had organizations in Israel, before all of that, as a one-man operation, then had the yeshiva. That's it. That's how it all started. Everyone else came after. So, my cousin was teaching there. Me and my friend Navarro went there to ask him some questions, to talk to him. Before they moved to the yeshiva where they are now, they were by caravans. It's like a big school with caravans. And the place where they used to learn was maybe 150 yards. Very big hall, very big. 100, maybe 300-400 kids learning, sitting and learning. Not kids, teenagers. Sitting and learning. And my cousin was one of the teachers there, one of the rabbis. As me and my friend sitting and talking to him, there's a line of all the people with their Gemara. They come like this, Rabbi, what does it mean here? What does it mean there? He looks at there, he answers them questions. Then one guy came and said, Rabbi, there's one guy, he wants to get accepted to the yeshiva. What should I tell him? He said, where is he? Over there, by the entrance. When? 50 yards away. Far away. So he say, tell him to walk inside, to walk a few steps. So I don't understand what's going on. Me and my friend, we look. The guy walked in. Then the other guy came back. No, what now? He said, tell him he can come tomorrow 9 o'clock. He's accepted. Like this. I said, what? You're not going to speak to the guy? He said, no, it's no need. It's good. I said, I never saw in my life such thing. What do you mean? What's the problem to speak to him 5 minutes? He said, don't you know that a person walks 10 steps, you know everything about him? You know his ego, you know his anger, you know if he's ungrateful, everything you know about him. Just by the way a person walks. If you learn the book on the body language, 100%. Why people stand with their legs open? Why people stand with their legs closed? Why some people are bending down? Why some people, their chest is always full of air? Why people walk with their hands open up? Some people walk with their hands like soldiers. Every little thing. Why people, when they talk, they move their eyes or their cheeks. Everything has a meaning. Everything has a meaning. By the way a person speaks to you, you go to a store, you know right away if it's a crook or not. If you learn this, you have advantage in life. You don't understand what advantage you have. You don't understand. By the way, women are very good at reading people, much more than their husbands. Much more than their husband. So if next time you want to invest money with a new partner, make sure you bring him to a dinner in your house at least once. I'm not joking. Let your wife, like they say in Hebrew, tit heal kan kano. Women have the sixth sense. Isha yesh la bina yetera. Bina means the ability to understand one thing from another. One thing from, that's not even the subject. From there, she got the point. Don't invest by him. Doesn't smell good to me. It always works. The women have this gift from Hashem, Bina Yetera. Man has to learn many years Gemara to get Bina Yetera. Women has it natural. Natural, Bina Yetera, Yesh Lanashim. It's unbelievable. So anyway, Rabotai, remember the first part of the lecture as its continuation to the last week's lecture. It's not what you say, it's why you're saying it. Why? Many times people compliment someone, but that's not their intention. Their intention is actually to put them down. The reason they compliment them because they wanted to bring their name to the subject, knowing there's an enemy in a room that as soon as he's going to hear it, he's going to begin a massive attack against that person. But I don't want to be the one that ruins his reputation in public. So I'm going to pretend that I'm objective and like him and everything is fine, bring his name up, knowing that crazy wolf over there, as soon as he's going to hear his name, he's going to attack and start cursing. And like this, I achieve my agenda. That's why the Gemara said that's a very big sin, to speak compliments about someone in front of his enemy. That's called Lifnei Iver Lo Titen Michshol, putting a trap in front of a blind man. Blind, not literally. Meaning in this field, he's blind. He's angry. He cannot control his anger, or he cannot control his mouth, meaning to eat. Don't put things over there that when he sees it, he will have to taste. I have to. I can't. I'm dying. Nah, that's the opposite. Yeah, you give a gozim to someone have shinaim, he cannot eat it as much as he wants. Still not, no problem. The idea is to give someone what he can do, but not allowed to do. That's the point. Not only that, I asked you before, when you do not rebuke someone, it's similar when you walk in the street and you see someone is drowning and you did not jump to save him. Which sin from the Torah you did? If it was a religious person, you violated ve'ahavta le'reacha kamocha. If it's not a religious person, there's no obligation ve'ahavta le'reacha kamocha. So let's not talk about this, because it's not always the case. But there is one sin that you have right away. When you see a person that you can rebuke, you can save him, you can do something, you can hand him a book, you can give him a few CDs, you can invite him for Shabbat, whatever the case is, and you ignore him, which sin from the Torah you just broke? Who knows? Lo ta'amod al dam re'echa. It's a very serious sin. Don't stand on the blood of the spilling blood of your brother. Meaning, the blood of your brother is dripping now. In 1 hour, he'll be dead. Instead of helping him to cure him, to save his life, you stand in the blood. Meaning, you can care less that he loses his blood. You don't care. Lo ta'amod al dam re'echa is when the ambulance service, they said that they need a type blood, whatever the blood is, and it's rare, and you're the one that has it, and they cannot find blood. They need to do transfusion, someone had an accident, and you can drive there 10 minutes and donate blood, and you're not doing it. That's also lo ta'amod al dam re'echa. Lo ta'amod al dam re'echa is when a person walks into the synagogue. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm a poor man, I don't have what to eat, they're throwing me out of the apartment, this and that, and you're a multi-millionaire, and you can just give him now a check for the whole rent, and you ignore him. See a religious guy with 11 children begging for peanuts, people give him quarter, a dollar, and you have $1 billion. What is it for you, $1,200, $1,500, to give him the rent? Instead of coming and say, come, how much you need? 1500. Here is the whole amount. Tiye bari. By the time you wrote him the check, you already made more money. I know people like this. Tell him, write a check for $1,000 donation. From the minute they take the check out of the pocket and begin to fill it up, $1,000 to Ploni, Almoni, they put the date and they sign. It took them a minute. That minute they made more than $1,000. We have thousands of Jews like this in our communities that make more than $1,000 a minute. I know some of them. Logically, you think, if a person makes $1,000 a minute, all he has to do is sit in a place all day and give money to people. What are you? Avrech. You have a letter, someone knows you're learning in yeshiva, yes. What's your situation? A letter, a few rabbis wrote, recommendation. Here. Goodbye. Next. What? I'm a widow. My husband died. Left me with this. How much you need? 5,000. Here. There are people that make a fund. Some rich people, they make a fund. They don't have time to start meeting people because they're busy making money. But they set up a reliable rabbi that he will do the job. They put all their 20% of their income into a fund. And people come, fill up applications, describe why they need the money. And this guy is sending checks every day. Hundreds of checks goes out. It's people like this. There used to be a guy like this in Muncie, moved to Lakewood. There's one in Brooklyn. It's big families that are very, very rich. That's what they do. They give out money. Today, Warren Buffett, the Goy, announced of another $3.5 billion donation. He already gave more than $20 billion to charity. Today, in one day, Today he announced, I'm giving another $3.5 billion charity. Warren Buffett and Bill Gates and few others, some of them are Jews, they formed a club, billionaire club. If you want to be in that club, you have to commit that more than half of your wealth will go to charity. And this is people that have $40, $50, $60 billion, meaning they commit that by the time they die, at least half of what they have will go into the poor people. Do you understand what I'm saying here or no? Goyim. Most of them goyim. Warren Buffett is not a Jew. Bill Gates. And they're not even religious people. Why? They got the point. If God gave me $70 billion or $100 billion and I keep making another billion and another billion, what is the point of all of that? Just to gain power? At least let me do some good things for miserable, needy people. That's the right way to think. Everyone has something to offer society. The problem is that many people are selfish. This brings us to the story of Korach. Korach, the richest guy in the world. It's Korach at that time, when the story takes place. Until today, 3,300 years later, when they want to say about someone in Israel that is rich, they have an expression. Rich means Ashir. Ashir ka Korach. I promise you that 99% of the secular Israelis don't even know what does it mean, Ashir ka Korach. Ask them, what does it mean, Ashir ka Korach? Who is Korach? They don't know. They never read the Chumash once in their life. They don't learn it in public school. So they don't know what it means, Ashir ka Korach, but they know it's probably someone was the richest. But they don't know. It's Korach from Shevet Levi. Korach comes and he gives a speech. What's the speech? He comes, he's saying to Moshe, someone that has a talit, that it's all blue, like the color of the tzitzit. Talit and tzitzit, same color. Does he need p'til tchelet in the strings? You need a blue one, or it's enough to have, today we only have white. Some people, for whatever reason, they decided to put blue in their tzitzit. You know how the people are. One person begins something, a trend. Everybody begins to imitate him. Smart people do not imitate anyone before they check carefully if what he does has a source. Foolish people that have no spine and no brain, everything they see in fashion, immediately they run to get. That's why you have people that dress today like homeless. Rich people walk in the street with the jeans, their entire leg is outside. It used to be a little cut. Now it's the whole leg is outside. So what's the point of buying these jeans? It's like walking with shorts. Why? Because these are serious losers that have nothing in their head. They saw some gay in Paris, decided to dress like a homeless, and tomorrow everybody imitates him. Regardless that he's gonna hang himself tomorrow in his balcony and commit suicide. One way or the other. Well, if he commits suicide, then he's gonna sell much more jeans with holes. That's his legacy to the world, that everyone should become homeless. You understand? So the idea is that most people, even in religion, even in our synagogues, people imitate others. It's all imitations. It's time for you to be who you are, really, without him imitating other people. So this guy Korach is the richest guy in the world. He took from Egypt so many donkeys full of treasures. He's already in a great position. He's a relative of Moshe Rabbeinu. But it bothers him. He wants now to challenge and to knock down the power of Moshe and Aaron. Why? What's the name of it in today's English? What do you call something like that? It's called politics. Politics. Many times you want to do something, they tell you, no, I'm sorry, we cannot do it. Why? The place is full that night. Baloney, the place is never full. A few rats over there, maybe. They fill up the place. But the place is not full, but they don't want you to speak. Politics. One of the members of the board, which is a very big rasha, put a veto on it. Because he's afraid he's going to speak about modesty. And his wife come, I don't want to tell you how, to the synagogue. You're pressing on his nerve. So what's the reason he's going to tell you, we're sorry, the shul is full that day? Not because it's really full. Because he's afraid that by you speaking over there, people would look at him and his wife and see their real face. So he doesn't want it. He doesn't want people to speak about something that bothers him. Obviously. Some people sometimes sit in a lecture. I look at the people. People don't look at each other. Everybody look forward, and I look at all the people. I see when I speak about subjects, which people from the audience commit those sins. From their body language. I see how they're nervous in a chair, and like this, and how they begin to play with their phone, or their hands is shaking. Yeah, you can see how they get irritated. You see, they don't realize. Later you show them a video of themselves. Wow, it's so obvious. Look how I became when you started to speak about this topic. But you need the merit to come to a lecture and to hear the speaker speak about what you need to improve. The fact that it happens, that means you're not in a black list of Hashem yet. Not yet. Because some people are already on a black list. Where does it say it? The Rambam. Rambam say clearly. Rambam say, Paro, the king of Egypt, had many chances to do tshuva. Up to the sixth plague, he can still do tshuva, and Hashem couldn't punish him. Sorry, God, forgive me. Hatati, Aviti, Pashati, Moshe, no problem. Take the Jews, go out of Egypt. We'll give you some gifts. We'll give you some whatever you want, some clothing. Forgive us. We didn't know God. We didn't know you, the children of God. We didn't know we're going to make him so upset. We really apologize. Please forgive us. You can take your property back. Nothing will happen to them. Pure power would become tzaddik just like Moshe Rabbeinu in one sentence. That's the power of tshuva, the power of repentance. And Moshe, the ultimate perfect righteous person, and Paro, the Adolf Hitler of that generation, and he can become Moshe Rabbeinu in 10 minutes by saying, really, but for real, not a fake. I've sinned, forgive me, I'm sorry, I'm ashamed, I'll never do it again. And he stick to his promise, that's it. Baal Tshuva. Yet Nevuzardan, the mass murderer of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. He murdered more than 20 million people. And what happened in the end? What happened? Did tshuva and converted. He became a Jew. Came to yeshiva with the Gemara. Good morning, Kvod Arav. Imagine Hitler, Yimach Shimo, after finished to kill all the people. How many he killed? 50 million? Now he comes to Germany, Rabbi Hirsch, Chatati, Aviti, Pashati, I'm so ashamed for what I've done. I want you to convert me, do me a circumcision on me, and I want to come in and learn with you Gemara every day. Please accept me. What would happen? The rabbi would say to him, oh, it's one thing, you're a monster, we all know that. We didn't know you're also mentally crazy. You come to me, you have the nerve to come and tell me, convert me? Well, when I put you in a mikveh, I make sure your head doesn't ever come out. That's how I will convert you. You know? How did they convert Nebuzardan? Big mystery. It's very hard for the brain to overcome the heart. Very hard. Very difficult. Today, if you say one comment about the Holocaust, someone that is a Holocaust survivor or a son want to murder you. They think with the heart, they don't think with the head. It's a very, very touchy subject for them. Breaks sensitive, it breaks their heart. Even if you say the truth, even if you read it from the Torah, even if you read that God said to Moshe that it's going to be a Holocaust one day, and he told him why, nobody can accept it. The horror that they saw, you coming to explain to me now from the Torah. That's why my rabbi told me, you know what your mistake is? Your mistake is that you don't understand that some subject, no matter how correct you are, and no matter how many times you show the people that it's written in the Torah, they will never be able to tolerate it. Especially if they are victims of something. For instance, if you speak about respecting the parents to a boy that was abused by his father. Total pure waste of time. Pure waste of time. What's the point? In his mind, his father is the biggest monster in history. The more you're going to try to justify that he should respect his parents, the more he's going to hate the religion. He doesn't think now that what God say and I have to listen and that. In his mind, this rabbi want me to respect this monster. I don't want anything to do with him and with the religion. That's it. No, there's no logic here anymore. Why? Because he's from his heart. In the heart. There's nothing you can say. That's it. You see how people react. So, Korach said to Moshe, you don't need a blue stripe. Today, like I started to explain, many people all of a sudden came with blue stripe. Somebody told them that they found the blood of the fish called chilazon. It's snail in English, snail. It's not a fish, it's snail. It has a... It's hiding inside the cover, shell. These snails, if you pinch them with a needle, where the blood is accumulating in the inside their body, they have blue blood, not red. Most animals and people have red blood. Those snails, perhaps one kind of a snail that grows in some ocean, the Gemara speaks about it. Those snails, when you take the blood out, you squeeze it out, it's come beautiful blue color. But you cannot take too much. The Gemara in Masechet Shabbat speaking about it. You squeeze the blood out, and you have to put them right back into the salty water or whatever. Why? Because if you don't do it, they'll die. If you take too much, so you have to know. It's a specialty to know how to squeeze this blue blood out of them. And with that, by the way, they painted the tent of the Mishkan, the portable Bet HaMikdash, and they painted the clothing, and then also the tzitziot. What's the purpose that you need to put one of the string of the tzitzit? You need to make it blue when the other ones are white. Why is it? Why one have to be different color? The answer is, because remember, today we have watch and we have calendars and we know when the sunrise is exactly. I can tell you now the sunrise from now until the next 20 years, every day. It's all calculated already. Even the U.S. Navy, they have on a website, according to the U.S. Navy, sunrise in New York, da-da-da. They have to know it. So, you know the sunrise. Sometimes it's 5 in the morning, sometimes it's almost 8 in the morning. Depends, summer, winter, it keeps changing, going up and down. Sunrise. Now, in the old days, if you want to say Shema Yisrael and sunrise, originally, you have to say Shema Yisrael and sunrise. We have the Sof Zman Kriyat Shema. We have 3 hours from the sunrise to say Kriyat Shema. 3 hours. But, Lechatchila, you have to say it in the nets. That's what Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul used to do. Wake up, make wash his hand, do Kriyat Shema in the nets. And daven in the 7 o'clock minyan in the morning. But to say Shema, like the Rambam say, Lechatchila, why zrizim makdimim la mitzvot? The faster you do the mitzvah, it shows how much you love God. If you keep pushing it and pushing it, later, 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 you know how much this person hates the mitzvah. It's like with your children. You come to your son. I want you to go and clean the dust from the window over there. Here, take a brush with some hot water. Just remove it. Soon. An hour later. Did you do it? Not yet. Soon. Another hour. No, did you do it? No, not yet. Don't worry. I'll do it. How many times you ask? Another hour later. No, you did it? No, soon I'll do. But it's already 7 p.m. Soon it's going to get dark. You won't see. No, no, don't worry. Don't worry. 2 minutes before, when mamash kvar, a whole war took place. You know, like you go to Home Depot and you ask the guy, excuse me, where can you do this for me? Can you mix some paint for me? If you find someone, you're lucky, sometimes it's 40 minutes. Excuse me, I'm busy. Don't you see I'm with a customer? Which customer? Why? They're not in a mood to work. What do you expect? I know one person, he has a very interesting way to solve this kind of issues. He comes to a place, see a lot of people, and you know, say, excuse me, with $50. It can be yours if you get me the thing ready in 5 minutes. Hold on, sir, I'll be right with you. No, no, no need, no need. It's my job. Take it. Next time I come, don't make me look for you. Up, everything gets done for them. What? They can afford. This guy walk all day, make $50. He comes, $50, finished. Right away, runs to do it for him. But that's the kind of society we want here. Technically, it's all bribe. Bribe. Today, in Israel. Israel. You build a house. They have to come and inspect the house. If you won't give them a nice gift, not all of them, of course, not everyone is corrupted, but many of them. If you don't give them a nice gift from day one when they show up, they'll take your heart out with a tweezer. You don't know what you're going to go through. Wait and see. Why the window is here? It should have been 10 centimeters higher. It's different than the plan. No, no, literally. Literally, with no shame. Okay, so the builder made it a little bit lower. What did I gain by that? It's not that I tried to cheat or something. Why the ceiling over here it's a little bit higher? It's more room. If you calculate the capacity of the room, you have an extra meter square. And what exactly I'm going to do with that when it's so high? What exactly I'm going to do there? I'm going to jump there to enjoy the air? No, but you're not going according to the plan. You don't understand what they're going to get you through. 4 years of nightmare. Everything you fix, they come with something new. Why didn't you say in the beginning? If you tell all the things in the beginning, a person says, I would give up the house. Just burn the house. It's not worth it to fix. But they don't tell you up front. Little by little, they torture you. Why? Because you didn't offer them 10,000 shekels. Shame on you, chutzpan. Such nerve you have not to offer him a gift. Israel is better. Imagine in Turkey or Egypt. Mexico? I drove with my host in Mexico. I said to him, do I need seatbelt here? He laughed. I said, over here you don't need anything. You just need to have $5 ready in your pocket. Why? If the amigo will pull you over, como está, señor? You go like this. $5. Oh, gracias, señor. Gracias, señor. Like this. Gracias, señor. Gracias. Dios que bendigo. Already become a baba. Give you misha berach. No shame. No shame. Some places you have to hint. Put it in a wallet. Hoping. At some places, there's no shame. That's the culture. Nobody cares. Nobody cares. It's unbelievable what corrupted world you live in. This is what's going on when you have no fear from God, that no one is afraid of God. The world becomes a zoo. So I started to explain, people want to have red tzitzit. Why? Someone told them that they found this blood of the chilazon. So they asked me, should I get it? I say, I don't get it. I have regular white. 2,000 years, everyone has white. All of a sudden, now people started to have blue. So what's the rule? The rule is like this. Whenever something new is invented, you have to check if there is a serious big rabbi that does it. If you have a serious rabbi that does it, then you know it's acceptable. If not, don't do it. So when people ask me, should I do this tzitzit? I say, Rav Chaim Kanievsky made this tzitzit blue. Rav Ovadia Yosef made this tzitzit blue. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul made this tzitzit blue. Rav Sternbuch made this tzitzit blue. Rav Karelitz, anyone? Show me one name of a serious Gdol Ador. One, find one. Oh, that means, because the Gdolei Torah, they never do things without thinking. The one thing you know, that if you see Rav Chaim Kanievsky does something, that it's new, that just came out, that may look strange to you, don't worry, you can sleep well. He investigated very carefully before he changed one of his habits. The big Gdolei Ashkenazim, they don't even change what they eat on Shabbat. Same food 90 years. Krepalach, Kneidalach, I don't know all the names, what do you call it? Gefilte fish, same the menu. Come, take some Moroccan salad, take some schug, take some, you know. The modern, they eat everything. They go restaurant, try Persian food, try this. Yes, modern. The big gdolim, you come to their table today. He eats what his father ate and what his grandfather ate all the way to the time the Ashkenazim started to go to Europe. They don't change anything. This is the way it is. Tradition, tradition. Even things that are minor, tradition. No one will change the hat. You move to Arizona, 110 degrees. Shabbat. 110 degrees, you take an egg on the hood of your car, open the egg, in less than a second you have a sunny side up. Ready, in a second. That's how hot the car is. You don't need an oven over there. I've been there once, I know what I'm talking about. 50 degrees Celsius, 1 hour in the sun you die over there. And you see, Hasidim move there, walk with a fur hat. It's heavy. In Arizona, the goyim over there went crazy. They made an article on the television. How is it possible? Why? They all walk, no clothes, everything open. You see, the Mexicans walk over there 12 hours in the sun. It's hard to believe. You stand there 10 minutes in the sun of Arizona, even though it's not humid there, but the heat. It's hard to believe. People to walk, making roads, walking all day under the sun. It's amazing. Anyway, let's move on. So Korach makes fun. Korach tried to break the authority of Moshe Rabbeinu. How can it be? How can it be? If you work now for Microsoft Brooklyn, if there is such thing, or Manhattan, and Bill Gates showed up, and he gave a speech to all the people of the company. And he nominated John Smith to be the president of Microsoft New York, in front of everyone. People took pictures, very nice, they had their dinner, the evening finished, and Mr. Gates got in his jet and left. Imagine the next day, one of the people that works for the company comes and make a demonstration against this John Smith. Why you took the job to yourself? Who are you? Why you the only one that deserve it? We all just as good as you. Smart thing to do or stupid thing to do? Very stupid. What do you want from me? The boss nominated me and not you. End of story. What would make a person declare a war and rebel against Moshe Rabbeinu. What is it? Jealousy? Anger? Hunger for mitzvot? Zealous? He wants to do the mitzvot? I started to explain, the faster a person does the mitzvah, the more it shows how much he loves it. If you love to pray Arvit, you don't wait for 10, 11, or 12, or 2 minutes before midnight. You run to the first minyan. Why? You waited, no, matai kvar it starts. Because you love it. You don't love it, you wait and wait and wait as long as you can wait to the last minute. Why don't you do it? Yeah, we still have time. Still have time. There's still time. There's still time. But zrizim makdimim la mitzvot. As soon as sunrise comes up, what? You run right away. Shkriyat Shema, and you run to shul. Why? Why should I pray later if I can do it the first shot that I have, first option? In business, when someone gives you an opportunity, you found a car that is half the price of its value. Someone just gave you a great opportunity. We'll go tomorrow. No. Your greed make you run, sprint to the place to get the car. Maybe someone else will come. Wait, don't hang up. I'm on my way. No, wait, stay with me on the phone. Why? Maybe by mistake someone else would come. This is it. When you want something and you love something, you don't wait. If a person has a date, he count the minutes when finally he's going to go out to that date. Finally he found a girl he loved after all these years. He was trying and trying. Now he already went 3-4 times with her. Oh, finally what I was looking for. And the next date is in 2 days from now. Let's say now it's Monday. They made it up for Wednesday. All he's thinking about, where is Wednesday already? When? No Wednesday. Wow, I'm going crazy. Wow, the time doesn't move. Rabbi, what happened? My watch doesn't work. He cares about his business now. Customers talking to him about the product. How much is this? How much is that? He's not in this world, Bechlal. Where is his mind? In Wednesday night. Why? Because he loves it. What he loves, you don't have to convince him to do. Ask your children. In the morning, Moishale, get up. What time is it? 7. 7. 7. Oh, why so early? The minyan starts in 15 minutes. Hurry up, no? Let's go. No, there's minyan later. What time? 8. I don't know. He doesn't even care if there is minyan or not. Just want you out of off his back. But if you come one day, Moishale, get up, what? We're going on a trip. Basketball, swimming pool, great ice cream. We're going to stop by the great pizza shop. Like a tiger. Before you finish the sentence, it's already after Netila. I remember myself. When my father, Alav HaShalom, every morning woke me up to go to school. School in Israel starts at 8. He used to wake me up before he goes to work. You up? First, when he woke up, he wakes me up. Then after bathroom, this, that. No, are you up? No, are you up? Usually it was 3 or 4 times. And of course, until I got up. But on Shabbat, 5 a.m. I was up already. From happiness that there's no school today. I promise you. My father used to laugh. He said, on Shabbat, you get up like a tiger. Why? From the happiness that today is a day off. That's how people are. In English, it's called a real loser. That's what it is. Excuses. In America today, there is a key word. Almost every American lives with the thought that he was abused. It's abuse. Verbal abuse, physical abuse, this abuse, that abuse. Today, if you don't give your son your credit card to buy a good steak in a restaurant, it's abuse. My father abused me. Yeah, if you saw what nightmare I had to go through, if you see how I grew up, believe me, you would understand why I'm a drug addict. What exactly you went through? You know, all my friends went on a trip to Israel for 1 month, hotels, this. My father didn't want to send me. Abuse. Father couldn't afford to pay him $10,000 to go on a trip. Abuse. Every one of my friends has a nice sport car and I'm taking buses. It's not abuse? Everything is abuse today. Once in 20 years you got a smack. Abuse. 911. My father is a serial killer. Why? He smacked me once in 10 years. He doesn't give me what I want. He hates me. Why did you bring me to the world to live such a nightmare? Where does he live? In a $5 million mansion. Every night he doesn't know which room I will sleep in tonight. But he's abused. Why is abused? Because they used to have 2 cleaning ladies and now there's only 1. So he has to bring the laundry down to the laundry room once a week. This is abuse American style. Then you can go to Syria and see what the real abuse is. Or in Sudan. You want to really know what abuse is? Go to Sudan, see 11 years old kids with machine guns. How they murdering people. And how they rape them from young age. That's abuse. That's a real abuse. But they grow up into that, into this reality. Over here, every little thing, abuse, abuse, abuse. My husband is abusive. Why is abusive? Because he works like a dog, like a slave, to bring food at home. Abusive. Because he doesn't want to let my kids go to summer camp and pay $5,000 on each one of them. Because he doesn't have $20,000 to pay for 6 weeks that the kids will play basketball. They can play in the neighborhood. I mean, $5,000 a kid, a lot of money for him. Poor guy, he's a manager in some store, make $1,000 a week, work like a slave. Sending the kids to a camp is going to be 6 months' work for him to save it. Does the father have this obligation to be a slave 6 months to work and kill himself that his children will play basketball in the summer in a mountain? Where does it say it in the Torah? However, the sad reality is today that camp is really not a privilege anymore. It's a necessity. Because if your kids won't be there supervised by some rabbis, they're going to be on the street taking drugs. That's the other alternative, unfortunately. Where else they would be? When we were kids, the streets were perfectly safe. Safe. You go down, you play, and you go to the school, play soccer all day, hours. Parents didn't have to worry. They didn't have what you have today. It's crazy. In Manhattan, if you live in Manhattan, and you have little kids, and they want to go down, where exactly are they going to walk? Every block is a life risk. Walking one block in Manhattan, in every block in Manhattan, it's a life risk. Kidnappers, pedophiles, drug dealers. What? You let your child walk, someone can kidnap him. Sell him on the market, in the internet. What are you going to do? It's so many risks out there. People are afraid. I know one guy, he told me my brother lives in Bnei Brak. None of his kids left the house after they come back from yeshiva one time in their life to the street. They don't leave the house. They're not allowed. So how is it possible? In Bnei Brak, the most religious town in the whole world, Bnei Brak. 99% Shomrei Shabbat, Bnei Torah, learning in yeshivot. The streets are not safe. This he told me 21 years ago. Today, Rav Shach told Rabbi Aderet. Rabbi Aderet told me that. You can ask him. When Rav Shach was in his 90s, about 15 years before he passed, a 90 years old man, holy rabbi, big Talmid Chacham, all his life lived by Musar. He said to him, stay in Monsi. He used to live in Monsi before he moved to Greene. Stay in Monsi. Don't come here. I asked him why. He said, I cannot walk out to Rehov Rabbi Akiva anymore. רחוב רבי עקיבא is the street, the main street in Bnei Brak, where all the religious stores are there. Clothing, you know, everything they sell, it's on that street. This, Rav Shach already passed probably 15 years ago, something like that. And this was 15 years before he passed. So that means we are talking about 30 years ago. Today it's 100 times worse. 100 times worse! Not 10 times worse. 100 times worse. 30 years ago when the streets were clean, not like today. He said to him, better you stay there, watch your eyes. In Monsi, there's nobody walks in the street, not Tzanua, nothing. I cannot walk to the street. A 90 years old man, big rabbi, tells you I cannot walk to the street. By the way people look, the way they look, how they dress, what's happening? What? The world is impossible anymore. You want to go to a wedding today. It's safe to go to a wedding? It's a life risk. Not life of your body. Life of your soul, which is much worse than a body. Can you find one kosher wedding that all the women there dress according to the halakha? If you find one wedding like this, I'll give you a prize. I promise you. One. Even by the most ultra, ultra orthodox weddings, you're going to have few of them sneak in with not modest clothes. The cousin, the relative, one woman that went off the derech, neighbor, I don't know what. There's no modesty. No modesty. You want to go to Manhattan to sell your merchandise. Can you walk one block in Manhattan today? You have to be blind to walk in Manhattan. You cannot open your eyes. You cannot open your eyes. What's happening there? It's 100% like going to the beach. 100% like going to the beach. If you see a person with a long beard and peyote and a black hat and a long jacket walks in the beach like this and look at the women over there, this person will ever be able to call himself a rabbi or religious or Hasidish or whatever you want to call it after something like this? If someone will take a video of him walking like this on the beach and looking at all the women who lay there getting 10. Somebody like that will ever be able to show himself ever as a religious person or no? Everybody agree? Walking in Manhattan is just as bad. There's no difference. No difference. Maybe in Manhattan you have much, much, much more people than the beach. Maybe it's worse. The world became an impossible place. Impossible place. And you know what's the worst thing is? The worst thing is that people became indifferent. They're very cold to the situation. Like, we got used to it. It is what it is. That's it. It almost does not bother anyone besides some people that are called fanatic. He's fanatic. Leave him alone. He's fanatic because he wants to do what the Torah says. Yes. Why do you want me to answer this question? Why do you want me to answer? To tell you to quit your job? Ask your rabbi what to do. If they offer me $1 million a day to work on a beach, opening those chairs, you know? The chairs that they have on the beach? The people in Israel, they walk, they bring chairs. How much? You give them 10 shekels, 20 shekels, they give you the ticket. $1 million a day. It's allowed? Not allowed, right? They offer you $1 million a day. What are you going to do? Walk with your eyes closed? Step over people's head? Obviously, you cannot walk there. When the world became just like the beach, there is a question is, how can we walk there? How can we walk there? If there is a way to walk in an environment that it's clean, meaning in your house, with your office, let's say you're a graphic artist. You don't go anywhere. You work on your computer, you design things, you send by email. Fantastic, you got lucky. There are some jobs that are still perfectly kosher. Everything else today, it's not kosher. Everything is not kosher. It's unbelievable. You want to work in a court. You know, these people that type. Impossible. You cannot control who comes into the courtroom. People sit there, just like the beach. You want to walk in a store, just like the beach. You want to be a bus driver, like the beach. You want to walk as a policeman, you're like in a beach. Every job today, it's not possible. Everywhere you go, it's not possible. I know people who do not want to work just for that reason. So I'd rather be poor all my life than to make money in this environment. I care for my soul. I care for my soul. Some people, when they move to Israel, where they move to Tzfat, it's almost impossible to find a job there. It's the end of Israel, by the border. But it's very spiritual and isolated. You can put yourself in some place in a mountain and never see any pritzus. Why? It's a religious area. You're on the top of the mountain by the grave of the Ari HaKadosh. You're not going to where the galleries are and all the tourists. You're in a religious area. You can be there all your life. The question is, how are you going to make a living? If you have money coming to you from some source, fine. Then you can do it. Really, in reality, the only people that do not commit sins every day are the serious learners in the yeshivot in Yerushalayim that don't leave the yeshiva, basically. House, yeshiva, that's it. In a block that has no pritzut, early in the morning, comes at night at home, doesn't have television, no computer, no smartphone. Those are the only people that there is a chance that they go a day without a sin. None of us has a day like this. None. Impossible. You go to the motor vehicle, sins. You go to the bank, sins. You walk on the street, sins. You go to a wedding, sins. You go to Brit Milah, sins. Everything. We can accumulate sometimes thousands of sins just walking on the street and going to our errands. Yeah? You want to eat in a kosher restaurant here. Here in Queens. Every one of the glad kosher restaurants. You sit. You want to sit there and eat with a friend, with your family. In 1 hour dinner, you already made 500 sins. All around you, naked women coming in, coming out, waitresses. Impossible. Even to eat a normal dinner, you can't. You walk in the street, all the signs, all the horrible pritzut. I'm not talking about the cursing and what the other things that you see and hear. The question is how Hashem will judge us. That's really the big dilemma that I have in my mind. Because remember, wicked people you always had in the world. There's nothing new. There was always atheists and kofrim and infidels and haters of Torah. There was always all kinds of horrible, terrible people. It was always like that. But it's never been like that, that you won't be able to walk in the street. There was no such thing. Because even by the Goyim, 1930, 1940, everyone was modest. No woman walked on the street 80% naked. There's no such thing. This is only in the last 40, 50 years that the world has come to the bottom of the bottom. A few times I put pictures of the Goyot in a beach on South Carolina from the year 1900. You have to see how they dress. Like brides in a Haredi wedding. Gowns like this, cover all the way with hats, with umbrella to cover their face. Everything up to here. Mamash, totally like a rabbitson. All the goyot in South Carolina. Let's see you walking 1 minute in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina today. 1 minute. You already lost your Olam Haba guarantee. One woman sent me an email today about her husband. She said, I don't know who she is, I don't know who the husband is, I'm just telling you a general story. She told me, my husband became very sensitive to modesty now, to the point that he does not want to invite to our house anyone unless he knows for sure that this is modest women. Meaning, if I want to invite my sister, or I want to invite a friend, or anything like that, Benji. So if I want to invite my sister or someone or friend, and he knows they're going to come not modest, he doesn't want. The question is, she said, she's a righteous woman. I'm not questioning my husband's decision. That's already a very serious level. Unfortunately, most women, it would be enough for them to get divorced in the stupid world we live in. But this is, Baruch Hashem, a righteous woman. So she's not questioning her husband's decision. She understands it. But she say, what will I answer my sister when she wants to come, as she used to, and I cannot invite her because she come half naked to the house? What do you answer now? That's a very big dilemma. Yeah, but when you tell women that are secular or semi-secular or very modern Orthodox to cover up, I don't have to tell you how they cover up. Maybe they put kippah on. That's how they cover up. You understand? They don't even understand the concept of being modest. That's really the problem is. That for them, a shirt that will be attached like a magnet to all the body as long as it covers the elbow. That's tzanua. Tzanua. So she asked me, can you give me a source from the Torah that I can justify my husband's choice to my sister? Who can give her a source? I gave her a source right on the spot. But who can give her a source? No. Source from the Torah that the husband is right. That he's not even fanatic. He only does what all of us must do. Very simple. Open the Gemara. First, it's written in the Torah, Elohim sone zima. Bilam gave advice to Balak to put goyot, pretty goyot on the street. I don't have to tell you 3,300 years how the goyot used to dress. Much more than the way we dress today. 3,300 years ago, everyone was covered with a tent. See how the Arabs would dress? That's how everybody used to dress. I show you a video from 100 years ago in Jerusalem. Turks, Arabs, Jews, hundreds of people walking the street, black and white. The first cars that came out, first cars, still donkeys and horses, and all the Turks with their mustache, you know, like this. You see history in front of your eyes in Jerusalem, in the Bukharian neighborhood, next to the Kotel. I always pay attention to all the details, not just to the video. Hundreds of women, all of them covered with a blanket like this. Everything covered. You cannot find one woman, not Sanua. Only 100 years ago. That's how the world was. You can do business. You can walk in the street without making sins. The Gemara said, if a man has two ways in front of him to walk, one path and another path, one is short and one is long. But the shortcut has women there. Women sitting. Women used to sit outside of the home with the children. I don't have to remind you what kind of women the Gemara speaks about. Strictly, strictly, strictly religious and modest. 2,000 years ago, there's no such thing dressing like today. 2,000 years ago, right? If I told you 100 years ago, there was no such thing. Needless to say, 2,000 years ago, right? So this is all women cover from head to toe. Totally. So he has two ways. The long way has no women. He has to go, let's say, around the block. And there is a shortcut to walk, but there are women on the street. And he walked through the shortcut, and he did not look at any woman that was sitting on the street. He walked like this, he took his hat off, he went like this, and walked in the side of the road to the other side of the road. What a tzaddik. His curiosity did not even convince him once to look and to see at least a little bit which women are sitting here. Didn't look at them. Fanatic! Today, if you see something like this, 500 people run after him. Kvod Arav, Kvod Arav, selfie. Kvod Arav, give my son bracha. How do you know I'm a Rav? I've been walking behind you. I see how you watch your eyes and how what a tzaddik you are. Please give me bracha. Please, Rabbi, bracha for this, bracha for my mother, bracha for my aunt, bracha for my grandmother, bracha for my neighbor, bracha. The whole day brachot. The Gemara say, what is he? Wicked, Rasha. 100% wicked. I hope you're clever enough to read between the lines what it means about us. Do you get the point or no? Or I should clarify it for you? You get the point. I don't think everyone got the point, but they will in a minute. The Gemara say Rasha is wicked. Why? The fact that he took such a risk to walk through a place that women are sitting there on the street, walking on the street, even though he did not fail, but the fact that he took such a risk shows he has no fear and shame from God. It's Rasha. Now, let's modify the story according to our days. There's no such thing, modest women on the street. And if you walk in a shortcut, I don't have to tell you what kind of women there are there. So it's needless to say that is 100 times more Rasha than the one 2,000 years ago who did not look. And even if he would look, he wouldn't see anything provocative. 2,000 years ago, what would he see? A woman that covered like this? No. So what did he see? Nothing. But modesty is so important and so strict in the eyes of Hashem that it's like playing with a nuclear bomb in your hand. Your hands are shaking. Chas v'shalom, not to make mistake. It's a genocide to walk as a woman, to become machtiyat arabim. That's why the women today don't understand, because there's nobody to teach them that. Almost nobody speaks about modesty anymore. Those who speak about modesty, right away, people hate them. Why? Because they tell them the truth in their face and they ruin the party. They ruin the party. They started to scream about the long wigs in the last few years. The few rabbis that non-stop talks about it, some people hate them. I can't listen to this guy. Why? All the time, wig, modesty, wig. Of course, it disturbs you because your wife walks like a model instead of a rabbitson. And you want to keep it up like this. So instead of saying we live in a lie and we are the losers, it's much easier to target him as an annoying speaker for shoving the truth in our face every day. If your doctor every day call you and ask you, no, did you stop smoking? Did you stop smoking? I told you it's dangerous. Stop, stop, stop. What happened in the end? If you don't want to quit, you come to people and say, this doctor is such a leech. So annoying. How many times he has to tell me this? What is who does he think he is? He's not going to say, I'm a loser. I'm such an effus that my doctor told me 100 times what needs to be done and I still cannot do it. You don't hear it. Did you ever hear a woman that say, I'm way off. I'm way off. He's right. I'm machtiyat arabim. I'm horrible. Yeah. Do you find? Show me that woman yet. Show me one that takes responsibility. They all begin with their excuses. Every time you speak about something, who defends it? The people that commit those sins. You speak about cigarettes, who always argue? The smokers. Anyone in the audience that doesn't smoke agree that cigarettes kill and is not allowed to smoke. Who would defend it? Those who are addicted to cigarettes. You speak about grass, that it destroyed the brains and killed the cells. Who right away will jump? Ah, nonsense, it's great, it's healthy. There's medical grass. Right away. Anything you will say, the people that do it will jump. You speak about long wigs, many women will get angry. They become your enemy, you're done. Why? Nobody wants to hear the truth. We live in such a world. Someone sent me today a little speech that Putin gave. I don't speak Russian. But from his body language, I got the point. It was an anti-liberal speech. The opposite speech of Hussein Obama would give. About the gays. They ask him, why don't you let gay parades in your country? And why don't you let the Sodom and Gomorrah that we have in America, why it's illegal in Russia? So he spoke for about 10 minutes in Russian. Why that's against the law in Russia. If someone will do such thing, he'll go to jail. They don't allow it. They don't allow brainwash for the children to speak about this in schools. When it became that goyim from Zera Amalek are smarter and more righteous than us, the religious Jews? That's what I'm asking. When did it happen? At what point Putin from Zera Amalek is more religious than many of the liberal religious fakers that I know? That pro-Obama and pro-gay marriage and pro-modern shuls with no mechitza and everything that Hashem hates, they love. Education. In the name of education and colleges to go against God and destroy His rules and books. Education. What kind of education? Does any education in the world that justify to make one sin? One tiny sin. That's not education. That's stupid education. Any book that will teach you, a professor or a college or a school or anything you want to call it, that will teach you to do one thing against the creator of the world, that's a stupid education. Because when you go against the creator of the world, there are major consequences. So if someone gives you an advice that will bring you to hell and you're going to be there for 100 years suffering and screaming, that's stupid education. And I don't care what's the name of that professor. And the problem is that most of the people are so blind that they cannot even tell anymore what's the right education and what's the wrong education. In the 70s in America, you have separate schools by the goyim, public school, not Christian schools, public schools. 50 years ago, the secular Americans still understood you cannot put boys and girls in the same class and expect not to have problems and lack of modesty. Again, 50 years ago, women used to dress. But they still did not want to mix boys and girls. Boys come from one side of the school and girls from the other side, and there's a wall between them. We came a long way to the bottom of the bottom in 50 years, in 1.5 generations. It comes to the whole world. Starts here, it goes to Europe, goes to Israel. Where else in the world you heard such thing? So Putin spoke. He has the power. He is not afraid of criticism. He's the most powerful man in the world, most powerful person in the world. He's not a religious person. I don't think he's a Christian that goes to church every Sunday. He's definitely not a Jew. He's not Muslim. He's not crazy about Muslims. But he has sometimes better opinions than some of the modern Orthodox people that I come along across when I see their comments in the internet, how they speak. They have no problem with gay marriage. They have no problem voting for Hillary Clinton and Hussein Obama that approves it. They also have no problem with abortions. They have no problem with supporting Iran and give them billions of dollars. They don't care that Israel will be wiped out, like most Americans answer in a survey. They don't feel any connection to Israel. They can care less what's going to be the end of Israel. But Hashem is going to wake them up. How? With anti-Semitism. I think 2 days ago they published a survey. They asked many Americans here if now it's the time to make in America rules against Jews, like they did in Europe. Many, many Americans say yes. Many. I don't remember the percentage, but it was unbelievable. Today you have a nice president. He loves Israel, he's nice to the Jews. The Jews stick a knife in his back every day. This liberal Schumer, Yimach Shimo, and all the others. And he's still nice to Israel, and he swallow his ego and continue to do the right thing for Israel and for the Jewish nation, for the minority of the Jews that supports him and admire and appreciate his work. Most leaders would not go for the minority. They say 70% of you are against me, all these liberals, all these lefties, all these newspaper reporters, all these owners of channels constantly stab me in the back. I will wipe you out. But Baruch Hashem, he's nice to us, always be nice, and hopefully will stay nice. What would be with the next president? What would happen if you have another president like Sharpton, Al Sharpton? What would you do if he's going to be? Or Buchanan, another Nazi? Then what would happen? There's a lot of Nazis in the South. It's just a matter of time until one of them will become the president. And what do you think will happen? First place he will come to destroy is New York City and Los Angeles. The two hearts of the liberal, Democrats, gays, Hollywood, corruption, Wall Street, banks, politicians. That's the source of all the problems. And who's running the show? Check the names. It's a matter of a few years, that's it. People think they're going to be here forever. You can be here four generations in America, and you're still a visitor. You don't believe me? Watch a YouTube show of the Nazis. How they say they want to leave the Jews? They can live only in one place. Let them go back to Israel. They don't belong here. But what do you mean? He was born in America, and his father was born in America. Doesn't matter. They don't belong here. That's what they say. At least they're not a hypocrite. Now when the Democrat Party is invaded by Muslims, as you can see, more and more Muslims are getting into power because the Democrats used to be the house of the Jews, all these liberals. But now they realize that from the Muslims they're going to get a lot more. It's many of them, they grow, a lot of them illegal comes here. That's the new generation here, to go with them. So therefore, automatically, who they're going to throw to the garbage? Those Jews who gave their life for them. These liberal lefties. They're going to be the ones that pay the price. There's not that much time left anyway. We are on the border of the salvation of the Gog Magog. Everything is ready to start. Everything is ready. You look around, you see what's going on. I always say, if Hashem won't bring Mashiach in our days, it's clear to me that there will not be any reason to bring him later on. There's not going to be nobody left. Who's going to see him? 2,000 people? 2,000 people will see Mashiach. Who's going to see him? The people that walks with miniskirt and high heels, the women, and everything attached and open, short sleeve, short ear, this, wigs all the way to the floor, they're going to see Mashiach. All the Mechalelei Shabbat will see Mashiach. All the gays, 20-30% of our society already, are they going to see Mashiach? All the corrupted bank managers and presidents and Wall Street executives that steal billions and millions from the miserable people and make them lose all their savings, are they going to see Mashiach? Pro-Palestinian lefty liberals in Israel, half of Israel, that fight for the Hamas to kill us? Racist Jews in the ultra-Orthodox community who murder children every day and not letting them get into yeshiva because of their last name or where their parents came from, they're going to see Mashiach. Bernie Sanders will see Mashiach, this guy. It's worse than Hitler in his ideology. Hitler wrote in his book that the reason that he fought the Jews is because the Jews are anti-God. Look what they did in Russia. The revolution, the communist revolution. Look what they did in Russia, he said. is anti-God, anti-Judaism. This is reality, Rabotai. We don't know how it's going to end. We don't know. We know what's written. If it's going to end like it's written, that's the worst possible scenario. Worst. Worst possible scenario. Today I got an email from a non-Jew, Goy. Is my impression from his email, it's not the first time he sends me an email, is that he's something in high-tech, some kind of a computer genius. He say, I feel an obligation to give a lot of money to CDs that you should save as many Jews as possible. He's not a Jew yet, still a Gentile 100%. I asked him, why? It's not, this is not your nation. Why you feel this obligation? So he answered to me, if that's what God wants, how can I not want the same? I love God, no? If this is what he wants, that all the Jews will return to religion and live according to the rules of the Torah, and this is what you do, you save another guy and another guy and another guy, that's the thing to invest in. Out of my love to God, I must do it, a goy. I was thinking to myself, maybe it's about time that half of the Jews will get the point like this goy. Technologically, there's no obligation to do it. But he got it. Then he sent me a picture of his library. He had to see every Jewish book he has. Gemarot, Art Scroll, this. Still not a Jew. More religious than so many other Jews who call themselves Orthodox, this guy. Still not a Jew. If he dies tomorrow, he goes to a different world. As the Torah said, that the Jews and the non-Jews are going to do different worlds when they die. Where does it say it in the Torah? The good news is that the Christians and the Muslims also admit that this is the book of God. If they wouldn't, then we will have an issue. It's our words against their words. But when all three religions admit that the Torah, that the Jews got in Mount Sinai in a public event, is the book of God, then when you read inside the text, and it's written that the words of the Gentile prophet Bilam, I want to live like the Jews, and I want to die like the Jews, meaning I want to live the life of the Jews, Tamud Nafshi Mot Yeshari. I want to die like the Jews, and I want to go where the Jews go when I die. That's a verse in the Torah by the head prophet of the Gentiles. This is the way God designed it, because if Moses would say it, then the Goyim would say, oh, he was a Jew, he is not objective. It's his opinion. No. The prophet of the Gentiles, Bilam, he is the one who say, I want to die like a Jew and I want to go where the Jews go. But he didn't want to live like a Jew. Remember what I always say it. In the last few weeks, I repeated it many times. Until finally people will get the point. The point is that over the years, Hashem is replacing the Jewish nation with Gentiles. You have to be blind not to see it. More and more Jews betrayed God and leave the religion. They assimilate with the other nation. They don't care about the Torah. They don't care about anything. No Shabbat, no Jewish hal, nothing. They put their children in public schools. They have no Judaism, no knowledge, no nothing. They marry anyone that comes. They don't care from what nation, what religion. They don't care. Some of them don't even care about circumcisions anymore. You have more and more gays, and more Mechalelei Shabbat, and more people who can care less about any religion, not just Judaism. And they leave their religion. After one generation, their children don't even know what they are. What are you? I don't know. My parents were not religious. We have no religion in the house. Those are the people who already got lost. They're not Jewish according to the Torah. And yet you have many, many thousands of Gentiles every year who convert to Judaism. So Jews leave the religion by choice, mostly because of ignorance, not because of evilness, because of ignorance. More and more, many thousands of Jews leave their religion every month in the world and assimilate and get destroyed spiritually. And more and more Gentiles discovering Judaism, especially today with the media and YouTube and all the CDs and all that, and discovering the truth of God and begging to convert and make a massive change. Massive change. Every day I get begging from Gentiles, help me to convert. Every day. It's not one day. You cannot find one day it doesn't happen. More, you have to understand, percentage-wise, it's also nothing. There are 7.5 billion Gentiles. Not even 1% is interested to convert. But how much is 1% from 7.5 billion? 75 million people, potential people, that have the merit and they come and they ask. Some of them, in the process, they drop out. It's too much for me, I can't do it. At least they discover they have to be righteous Gentiles. Very good. Easy to be a righteous Gentile as compared to be a kosher Jew. It's much, much, much easier. Most Gentiles are not murderers. Most Gentiles do not commit sex crimes with their 7 closest relatives. Most Gentiles are not gays. Most Gentiles don't sleep with animals. Most Gentiles do not come and steal all day and running to steal from people. Most Gentiles don't eat animals unless they dead first. Most Gentiles, if they are Arabs or Muslim, they believe in one God. If it's Christian, they have a very big problem. Because they're all idol worshippers. Christianity is idol worshipping. Islam, however, it's not idol worshipping. Maybe it's more aggressive, maybe it's pro-killing and murder. Okay, maybe. But there's no idol worshipping over there. Arabs used to be idol worshippers. Actually, when Muhammad came and gave them the Quran, even though it's a false book and it's not from God, the one good thing that happened is that they all became believers in one God. 2,000 years before the Islam, all Muslims were idol worshippers. It's written that the Arabs that came to Abraham, he went and to wash their legs because they were all idol worshippers and they walked into his house. They did not have a religion. Every Arab believed in a different idol. The word Arab comes from the word Arava. Aravim, Arava. Aravi, it's Arab in Hebrew. Arava means the wilderness, the desert, the open desert. That's where they used to live. Aravi and Ivri. Pay attention, the same letters. We all came from the same father, Abraham. Ivri, Avraham Ivri, and the Arabs that came from him, they got a name similar to Ivri, Aravi. You can call them by many different names. You call them Ishmaelim. That's how the rabbis called them, Ishmaelim, from Ishmael, their father. But the word Aravi, it's the same letter like Ivri. Ayin, Resh, Bet, Yud, Ivri, it's the same letters, just different orders. You understand? So the reality is, unfortunately, it's very good that more and more Gentiles discovering Judaism and convert. It's very good. When I say unfortunately, I'm talking about the other half of the story, that so many Jews are getting lost. To the point that if the situation will continue like this, besides the very ultra-Orthodox, some Hasidic and other fanatic people in religion, basically everyone will get lost. All secular, all modern people, reform, conservative, they're all intermarried. After 2-3 generations, nothing is left from them. The only one that will survive are the very, very yeshivish Orthodox families that will stick to the rules, no matter what. And more Gentiles will become more and more Jews. The good news is, when the Gentiles finally get converted, after they sacrifice, they leave their environment, they change their lifestyle, usually they are very serious. They didn't do all that to go back to live like the way they used to live. Even though Here and there you find out about Gentiles that converted, were religious for a while, and then went back to be not to keep mitzvot. That's, by the way, the dumbest decision that a person can make in this world. There's nothing dumber than this. Nowhere, by no place, by no subject, there's a worse decision than this. That you are a free Gentile, and you can do whatever you want on Shabbat. You don't have to keep Shabbat. You can eat whatever you want. You don't have to eat kosher. You don't even have to get married. You have a girlfriend, you can be with her without marriage. Gentiles don't need to get married. They don't have marriages, they don't have divorce according to the Torah. They imitate the Jews, so they bring somebody to marry them, but they don't have an obligation. So their life is a lot easier. They can eat basically everything besides living animal. They can live, he has a girlfriend, he lives with her for a few months, they can have children, the children are legit, there's no problem. It's not like Christianity brainwashed them that if you have a kid from a woman that is not your wife, he's a mamzer, he's an illegitimate boy. It's nonsense. He's a kosher kid, kosher Gentile, just like everyone else, because by the Gentiles, God never said that they have to get married. They make up their own rules, the church. Where the church come from? It's a fake religion. Okay. So everything there is fake. But the idea is that their life is a lot easier now. They come and say, I want to be Jewish. I want to live by the rules. Why? Because that's the right way, or because I want a better heaven, or I want to end in a better place. Okay, very nice. But it's not so simple to live according to these standards. Bilam wanted to die like a Jew, and he wanted to go where the Jews go, but he did not want to live like a Jew. That's it. If you want, you have to work, you have to sweat. Adam la'amal yulav, life is not a picnic. Already the Gemara told you, he did not come here to get a tan in Cancun. Like some Jews think that that's the purpose of life. Every 3 weeks to be in a different place for vacation. There are people, believe it or not, between June and the end of August, they take 3 vacations, not one. Most people barely can afford one. So they go somewhere. Some people, 3 vacations they take. Why? Their life is so empty, they keep need to go to places. Because it's so boring. There's nothing in life. Only materialism. Materialism you have to keep changing. You cannot go for the same materialism. One time you buy a watch, you're excited for 2 days. Then you buy a car, you're excited for 2 weeks. Then you buy a beautiful mansion, you're excited for 6 months. Then you don't like it anymore, so you sell it and you buy another place. Then you move. You don't like New York anymore, so you move to Miami. Then you don't like Miami, then you move to LA. Then you say, you know what, let's move to Israel. Confused. No direction, no purpose, no understanding, nothing. Check around, see what's going on. Check around. Call your lawyer. See if every 2-3 weeks he's not in vacation. Can I speak to Mr. X? I'm sorry, he's on vacation. He'll be back next week. 3 weeks later, you call again. Hi, may I speak to Mr. X? He's in vacation. He didn't come back. He came back, but he went to another vacation. No joke. Try it. Try and see what's going on here. It used to be a song in America when I was a teenager. It used to be everybody working for the weekend. In America, people used to be slave 5 days a week to celebrate for 2 days. Parties, beach, beer, sports. Now they have to change the song. It's not only for the weekend. It's for the vacations. Life is a picnic. Picnic, there's only one problem. This picnic has a price. Not money, I'm talking. Has a price. When you come to the next world and you stand in front of God, every moment of your life will be analyzed. How embarrassed you're going to be when half of your life you're laying like in the sun like this with tons of oil on your body. So Baruch Hashem, no, you became very dark now, no? So what, then what now? Then you're gonna have, you remember over here you laugh, but over there it's gonna be a massive shock because that's the world of the truth. every one of your sins will be revealed in the court of heaven. Imagine that in the middle of your trial, you will see that from 80 years that you live, 40 years you were laying like, I don't know what, like a dog in the sun, or like the lion in the Bronx Zoo. You know the lion in the Bronx Zoo? 30 years is in the same position. Getting 10 on the rock over there. If it's the same one, maybe they replaced him, I don't know. What does the lion do all day? Like this. You came to the world to be a lion? Move a little bit the bugs, the flies. That's what he does. His wife goes to hunt, to bring food, and he's all day laying in the sun. What the monkeys do? Play basketball all day. Shh, jump, dunk, dunk, throw coconut. That's why you came to the world, to be a basketball player? That's the purpose? What people do? Every one of us is trying to imitate a different kind of animal, or few of them combined. When the Torah say that there's a big difference between a person and an animal, obviously. You have the divine soul, they don't have it. Why all animals, there's not one animal that can stand straight like human being. When you stand, you stand like a straight line. The monkeys, they bend down. They cannot stand straight. Even when they try to stand on two legs, they still bend down. All animals walk on four, and those who can walk on two, they always bend down. Why is it? Because they are pointing to where they came from the ground. They were made from the ground, just like our body made from the ground. There's only one difference. We are half from the ground and half from God. And they are 100% from the ground. That's why they're always going towards the ground. And when we get old, we shrink. And many of us become hunchback. Some you can see, some you can't see. But we all bend down a little bit when we get older. We don't stand straight like when we are young. Why? Because we're heading to the ground. That's why we begin to bend. Everything has a reason. Why the name of Adam is Adam? Because he was taken from the Adama. Adama is the ground, the sand. That's why his name is Adam. Everything has a reason. Why the name of the soul is Neshama? Neshama. Because as long as you noshem, noshem means breathing. As long as you breathe, the soul is in you. Once you cannot breathe, the soul left your body. That's how you know if a person is alive or not. As long as he breathes, he's alive. Once he cannot breathe, he's dead. Kol asher neshama be'apo. Everyone that has a soul in his nostrils, the soul enters from the nostrils and leaves from the nostrils. I had a guest in my house this Shabbat. We'll finish with this story. A great guy. Great guy. Used to, before he became religious, he was some kind of a poker champion. Used to make a lot of money in casinos. Very nice looking guy. His father passed away and left him a lot of money. With everything he had, he realized that that's not what life is about. Started to get closer and closer. And I had Baruch Hashem the merit to bring him closer and became very religious, Baruch Hashem. Now he lives in Israel, he got married to a religious girl. But he's a businessman. He comes, he goes. He was here now for America, he came to me for Shabbat. We spoke about his father when his father passed away. So his father was not a religious man. They told him at least put tefillin, he refused. He said, that's not my truth. Because I'm desperate, I'm not going to do things. A stubborn man. So he was talking about this. Then he told me, I was sitting next to my father when he took his last breath, looking at his face. He told me, I got the shock of my life. Remember, it was a secular, rich Israeli kid from the richest neighborhood in Israel, Herzliya Pituach. It's like Beverly Hills of Israel. The houses there, just, they can definitely be in Beverly Hills. That's how fancy they are over there, by the beach. So he was looking in his father's face, and he told me the last breath he take, his nose got like blown up like a balloon. And everything turned to the side. So I got the shock of my life. I look at my father, knows how it all moved. It became very big and moved. And that's when he died. Just like it says in the Kabbalah, the soul enters from the nose and leaves from the nose. And people that die clinical death, they will tell you, I came out, and then when I came back into my body, I was sucked right back into my head through the nose. And it's written in Genesis 1 that God created Adam, sent from the ground, and he blew a living soul into his nostrils. And how a person dies, the soul goes back to God that gave it. It's written in Qohelet, King Solomon. And the soul remained back to God, returned back to God that gave it. And the body will return to the ground because that's where he came from. Not cremation, not burning the body and put it in a jar or giving it food to the fish and to the sharks. No. The body must go back to the ground. If the body does not go back to the ground, the soul will never ever rest. Some kids torture their parents for eternity by not burying them. Even Gentiles. Gentiles must go back to the ground. Same thing. Same thing. Their body came from the ground. It has to go to the ground. That's why they have no rest. There's even a question if animals can be cremated or no. Animals. Because there's no verse in the Torah that animals has to go back to the ground, but with using your logic, animals were also made from the ground. The body is made from the material, same material. We have 99% same DNA in our body, like the monkeys. 99% same DNA, same body. Just they're more hairy, that's it. By the way, if you think we're smarter than the monkeys, think again. They're much more intelligent than us, and they have a much better memory than us. I can show you a video. They put on a screen 12 numbers in squares. 1, 2, 3. But the way they did it, it's blink for 1 second. 1 and disappeared. 2, it's in a different place. 3 in a different place. 4 in a different place. 5 in a different place. 12 flashing numbers for 1 second. They asked students from the university, after they finish to display the 12 numbers, to press on a screen by the right order where the numbers were. One was here. Maximum they remember 3 or 4 numbers. 1, 2 was here, 3 was here, 4 was here, 5 was in the middle. The monkeys, you have to see how they do it. Tak, tak, tak. 12 numbers. All of them. 12 numbers. I had the shock of my life when I saw it. A chimpanzee has much better memory than some of our rabbis. Yes. I wouldn't remember 12 numbers in the right order after they've displayed for 1 second. I get confused after 4 or 5 numbers for sure. Monkey, the chimpanzee. You have to see that. Every time they click 12 numbers, they get 2 peanuts coming out of the machine. Who saw that video? Anyone saw that? It went all over WhatsApp. You saw it. Here, another witness here. Am I exaggerating or no? 100%. Chimpanzee better than a Harvard graduate in his intelligence without paying $200,000 to Hussein Obama. Here. Yes?
I waited 20 years.
Time ran out. It's already 10:30. Baruch Adonai Leolam.